takes me over. Face down, emptier than zero.
Mesdames et messieurs, nous sommes ici au transbordeur de Lyon et nous sommes le 28 avril.
Il fait beau, tu notes.
Et il fait beau, oui, nous avons un ciel bleu, pas un nuage.
Et pourquoi nous sommes là, mon petit Philippe?
Et nous sommes là parce que ce soir se produit un grand groupe au transbordeur. Alors on parle en même temps.
Exactement,
et on dit la même chose et c'est excellent, mais on le dit de deux façons différentes, ce que je trouve excellent. Donc un grand groupe se produit ce soir à Lyon. Moi je voulais donner un petit peu de suspense avant d'annoncer le nom. C'est bien entendu Marie Lyon que nous allons interviewer dans quelques minutes.
Effectivement, car nous sommes à Lyon aujourd'hui, nous sommes d'ailleurs, vous le savez, là-dedans va se produire l'incroyable, oui, Monsieur Passe, il a le droit aussi de vivre, Philippe.
Oui, tout à fait.
Là, je suis devant les accès backstage, là où les artistes rentrent. Ils vont sortir ici pour signer les autographes après le concert. Genre, effectivement. Et regarde, suis-moi, mon petit Philippe. Qu'est-ce que je te montre?
Tu me montres un bus.
Qu'est-ce que je te montre? Je te montre un bus, mon petit Philippe.
Oui.
Un bus, et pas n'importe quel bus, c'est le bus de Marie, ce qu'on appelle un tourbus. Tout ce qui se passe là-dedans, et bien écoutez, qu'est-ce qui se passe là-dedans, mon petit Philippe, là-dedans?
Je ne veux pas le savoir.
Des choses, beaucoup de choses.
Voilà. Alors on dit que certains groupes écrivent des chansons pendant qu'ils vont en concert, et donc pendant qu'ils sont dans le tourbus. Alors je ne sais pas si c'est le cas pour Marie Lyon, mais en tout cas, voici un de ces fameux tourbus qui emmène de nombreuses stars dans les salles de concert du monde entier.
Exactement. Alors ce qui va se passer, c'est qu'on va faire maintenant l'interview de Marie Lyon, et plus particulièrement du claviériste, et ça c'est sur Radio Métal.
Tu immortalises le moment, en fait, c'est ça?
C'est bon? On peut y aller? Non?
Probably more live than some of our other albums, because the way that we work with Mike Hunter, he tends, you know, our producer who produced somewhere else, he likes to try and capture a more live sound, I suppose. So there wasn't too many layers of sounds added on afterwards, you know. And a lot of it, some of the songs actually came from jams rather than, you know, being completely arranged first. The first single, See It Like a Baby, was sort of created from a jam, really.
And did the fans participate financially to as they did it for the
Lord of the Rings? No, they didn't.
What?
I said, do you want me to talking to him?
No,
that's fine, okay. It'll be fine, yeah, just because of the noise. Okay. No, they didn't. We decided not to do that this time. I mean, we did it for Anaragnophobia and Harvest, but on this album, well, one, we didn't need to do it for financial reasons, and we just thought that, you know, fans would maybe get fed up with us asking them to pay for albums a year or so before they got them. So we didn't need to, really. We still had some money left from the last time.
Okay. In 1995, you recorded your last album with EMP, and then you decided to stop working with them. When you are a famous group, isn't that boring to record an album like a young band?
Not at all. I mean, we parted company with EMI after Afraid of Sunlight because, you know, we've made 8 albums with them and we just felt they weren't really interested in Marillion anymore, and the people there weren't the same people from the early days, and it was just the wrong company for us at the time. So we thought that we would go to an independent company, you know, someone smaller, someone who cared a bit more, you know. That was the idea anyway. So we signed an album, a 3-album contract with a company called Castle, which turned out to be even worse. They were much worse than EMI. They were small and useless. Yeah. So after that, we were completely fed up with all the record companies, and that's when we came up with the idea of asking the fans to finance the album. That was in 2001, when we made Anorakophobia. And since then, we've been happy, you know, being independent ourselves. And I mean, we still use distributor, you know, we manufacture the CDs ourselves, and then we sell them to distributors, and they sell them at the shop. So it still works in a similar way, but it just means that we don't have to deal with idiots from record companies. You know?
Concerning the songs, Circular Ride, A Real Tears, Say the World, or State of Mind, will you release that song? Because Steve Coyote said last year that those songs were controversial in the band.
Yeah, we will release some of them. We've got another single coming out soon, and we might use, I think we're planning to use 2 or 3 of them as big sites for that. So, yeah, there's a little bit of disagreement about what to do with the songs, you know. So we'll see. Yeah, we're going to use a few of them anyway, definitely. You know, we'll see.
Okay. I personally really like the song Thank You of Whoever You Are. So what's this about? Can you tell us more on that?
I only wrote the music about it, not the lyrics. I don't really know what it's about. You have to ask Steve. I honestly, that's the one song on the album that doesn't really, that I don't really understand. So yeah, whatever it means to you, really. I think, you know, thank you. I think it's a sort of a thank you to you know, that Steve's now.